Good morning. So it's been a couple of days since I've last uploaded, but what I wanted to do was just take a couple of days off from filming and work and really dedicate some time to Mabel. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to give you an overview of everything I've done in this first week. She's exactly 9 weeks old now, so we've had her for 6 days, but this is a 9 week birthday, so we've had her for 9 weeks. I'm going to show you what we've done in terms of socialization, obedience and manners, and we'll start off with socialization, which has been amazing, especially with my Labrador Sully, who has been an absolute dream and a perfect role model dog. We've had her out to different places in the public, we've met lots of different dogs, different people. We're out on in the woods today and she's getting her first experience out in the forest and the leaves and all those kinds of senses, smells and environments. The socialization has been amazing, and I did try and get some clips, so I'm gonna roll that footage now and I'll see you a little bit later on. I hope you enjoyed those clips, guys, and found them as cute as I did. But what I want to focus on now is kind of where we're at with obedience work. So I've filmed some footage here. This was this morning in our formal obedience session that we do before every mealtime. And I want to show you that we're really getting there with luring now. The problem is sit has become so dialed that during formal sit sessions, all she wants to do is sit and expects to get the treat. So we've had to kind of take a little step back and move back towards luring. But as you can see, sit is absolutely nailed down now. We've got sit on the marker, sit on the cue, sit brilliant. So our main focus has been on sit and stay, and as you can see here, sit and stay is really good. Obviously she's just turned 9 weeks, so we're going to have a few breaks, and if I remember rightly, during this training session she did try to break during a stay a couple of times. But obviously, because like I just mentioned, her sit has kind of become her default. If I sit, everybody's happy. What I'm doing now is I'm breaking up the sit and stays with some luring movement, so I'm getting her to follow around. As you can saw there, she breaks, so I didn't reward her, she didn't get the treat, but I didn't scold her or anything. She's still such a baby, she didn't need correction at that point. We just put her back into the sit and we rework it. The act of not getting the treat was more than enough of a correction at this stage. And with these kind of obedience work, it's very, very rare that you need to use any form of correction. It's not necessary. More about patience and consistency, and not rushing these things. But as you can see, we're really working on creating a little bit of space, adding a little bit of time. Eventually I won't just be leaning back, but I'll start to take steps back, then I'll start to leave the room, things like that. And as you're going to see on the next clip, we're going to build up our food manners, and that will also really work with sitting and staying. And then once you've got it nailed, you'll find yourself using it in just so many different environments and different situations, like when you're getting out the car, any form like that, sitting or staying. If you meet someone on the street, to sit and stay is brilliant. So as you can see here, we put the food down, we've got a really good sit. And we got a very good stay there. But what I'm looking at doing is getting eye contact before she can break, because I'm really reinforcing that you need to look at me for direction. If you look to me for direction, I will then tell you what it is that I want you to do. And that will usually involve some positivity or reward. So I got her in a very good sit and stay here. And you can see, boom, I got the eye contact I was looking for. And that's huge progress, if you remember from the last video, where she was flipping and bucking around all over the place, to now we've got the sit nailed and we're very close to having the stay nailed before she can break. Really happy with the progress on obedience, but we'll talk about manners now in a second.
Oh, so that has been a long day. So I've kind of caught you up on obedience and socialization. They're both going really well. So let's talk about manners, and we'll start off with what's going well, and that's things like you saw the sit and stay doing brilliantly, and that's a foundation block for so much of the manners work that I talk about in our Perfect Puppy course. So if you are new here and didn't understand, I'm a canine behaviorist, I've got my own Perfect Puppy course, and this channel is kind of documenting me following that from day one to show you the proof in the pudding of what can be achieved if you follow a step-by-step course and you know what you're getting into from day one. Now, I'm being very open and honest, and there's always no one size fits all, and you've got to be flexible, and that's why I teach the theories of dog training so that you understand the why rather than just the what, and that way you can be flexible when things change, like I'm going to discuss in a minute. So sit and stay, doing really well, and that's the foundation of so much of our manners work when it comes to having a perfect canine companion. You saw that with the food. Once we get that nailed down there, that can then work for door manners. It can work when we're out in public. Like I said, brilliant foundation. Obedience coming on amazingly. Other things in manners, jumping up, absolutely brilliant. Nipping, the best puppy I've ever worked with when it comes to nipping. It's pretty much non-existent right from day one. It's been brilliant. Very, very minor little bits I've had to do, and just redirecting to appropriate chewing materials has been an absolute doddle. But what we are struggling with, which sits into the manners category, is crying. Now, like I say, that's why you need to choose the right breed for you and then temperament select the right breed. And with everything kind of comes pros and cons. There's no one perfect dog breed. There's some dogs with different pros for different people, but those same pros might be cons. And what's a pro here often causes a con here. Now, the Connie Corso, I wanted to choose one that was amazing with the family, builds really strong bonds, is defensive naturally of their environment, their home, and their loved ones, and gives you that mastiff-like bond that is like no other that I've discussed on loads of other videos. Now, kind of the flip side of that is that they absolutely love their people. I also went out my way to temperament select a very relaxed, submissive, extra lovable, gentle puppy from the litter to ensure the best case starting from day one that they'd be brilliant with my two young sons. So like I say, where those are all positives, the knock-on effect is that it makes her already kind of come into this world pre-ingrained, ready for separation anxiety. She is a loving, gentle sweetheart, and she just wants to be touching me and touching my wife and touching the boys and be with us all the time. And the second you take that away from her, she goes full meltdown. You saw it in an old video when I was trying to get her used to going in the boot of the car. Same thing happens if you leave her in a room, even if you just pop to the toilet or pop to the kitchen. So I'm really happy with socialization, I'm really happy with obedience, but moving forward for the next week, we're going to be really focusing mainly on crate training, getting crate training absolutely perfect to then really help with separation anxiety and being able to leave her in a safe, enjoyable, positive place that'll help break that bond of not being with somebody 24/7. Now, that's especially worrying for me because I work from home. And although I work from home and I'm really looking forward to having a Connie Corso be with me all the time, if I start out like that, I'm setting her up to fail, because naturally there's going to be times I want to go to the gym. I'm really looking forward to getting back into some Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and a little bit of MMA that I used to do a few years ago. Obviously, they can't come to those things. There's going to be times where if we take her on holiday, she's not going to be able to have free roam of the house like she might do here. If she goes to the vets or the groomers, there's lots of scenarios where dogs should be in a crate, and crate training is amazing when done well. It gets a bad rap from a lot of people, but that's from people using it for punishments, for leaving them in there too early, too long, too early. There's lots of ways you can do bad dog training with crates, but there's lots of ways you can do bad dog training with anything. Any of the tools that you use, all of those tools used in the right way can be superb. So next week, I'm really going to be putting 90% of my focus into getting crate training nailed and building up that ability for her to calmly allow us to leave and for her to be on her own. That's kind of the next priority. After that, if we can get that nailed, I'm super excited for seeing how quickly and how smart her little mind is. I'm really going to look forward to doing some obedience work with her. But my biggest kind of getting ahead of the game and trying to solve a problem before it arises is going to be separation anxiety. I've spoke to other people that have Connie Corsos and people that have raised them, people that I look up to and I respect as much as a lot of you guys watch me for tips and advice. None of us are perfect. We're always learning. We're always growing. This is the first Connie Corso puppy I've ever had. So I need to learn those breed specific tips and tricks that I want to take you guys on along for the journey. There's obviously all the umbrella overarching theories that I can help people with, but those intricacies that are breed specific, I've been speaking to friends that have got Connie Corsos that I really admire, their Connie Corsos and their training. They've been brilliant and given me some good advice and some good reassurance, which oftentimes you need, because puppy training is difficult. It can be emotional, it can cause a lot of anxiety and stress and be overwhelming, and you can have that like, oh my god, what have I done? I can't cope, we can't live like this. But what you need to do is just be able to have the no, it's okay. Either watching videos like this, hopefully in the future, if you're watching this video, you're also gonna have months worth to see that where I'm struggling with crying now and putting a plan in motion, you'll see that plan work. So in 6 months, you're like, oh cool. As if that dog used to struggle with crying, and my dog struggles with crying, but if that dog can do it, then I can do it. That's really what I want these videos to be. So I'm rambling on a little bit. Hope you enjoyed the catch up. Like I say, I'll do a dedicated video on crate training and separation anxiety. We're not far off her having a second round of jabs. When she has a second round of jabs, then we can really get stuck into taking her to some fun, cool places that will make for much more entertaining, fun vlogs. So I can get the drone out, I can get some cool gimbals out. I'm really excited to kind of challenge my abilities at making cool videos just as much as making them educational for you guys. So I'm really looking forward to doing that. So if you are new here, don't forget to subscribe. All the links to my course, to all the products I recommend for puppies, everything as always is down in the description box below. And I'll see you on the next episode of Will and Mabel.